a day of the Lord. The term day of the Lord appears in the books of Isaiah, Ezekiel, Zechariah, Amos, Obadiah, Zephaniah, and finally in the last book of the prophets, Malachi. In Ezekiel and Zechariah, the day of the Lord is said to be only against the nations, and in Obadiah against Edom and Esau, Christianity, and the nations. Basically, they're saying the Gentiles in general, and in particular, the Christians. Those who told you to get down and walked all over you. Those who took your book and called it their own. Those who told you your God had let you and came to them because you were such sinners. But isn't it funny? The only reason they don't consider themselves great sinners is because of a human sacrifice God gave to them. So he wouldn't see them as sinners, but he saw his people as sinners and left them. It makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. The prophets warn that the day of the Lord is near, but it is not the end of the world. The wicked and sinners will be punished and justice established. These are some excerpts from those books. Lo, the day of the Lord is coming with pitiless fury and wrath to make the earth a desolation, to wipe out the sinners upon it. Isaiah chapter 13, verse 9. For a day is near, a day of the Lord is near. It will be a day of cloud, an hour of invading nations. A sword shall pierce Egypt, and Nubia shall be seized with trembling, and then fall slain in Egypt, and her wealth is seized, and her foundations are overthrown. Nubia, Put, and Lud, and all the mixed populations and Cub, and the inhabitants of the allied country shall fall by the sword with them. Ezekiel chapter 30, verses 3 through 5. Yet even now, says the Lord, come back to me with all your hearts and with fasting, weeping, and lamenting. Rend your hearts rather than your garments and turn back to the Lord your God. For he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in kindness, and renouncing punishment. This is Joel chapter 2, verses 12 through 13. But everyone who invokes the name of the Lord shall escape, for there shall be a remnant on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem, as the Lord promised. Anyone who invokes the Lord will be among the survivors. That's Joel also, chapter 3, verse 5. For I have noted how many are your crimes and how countless your sins. You enemies of the righteous, you takers of bribes, you who subvert in the gate the cause of the needy. Assuredly, at such a time, the prudent man keeps silent. For it is an evil time. Seek good and not evil, that you may live, and that the Lord, the God of hosts, may truly be with you, as you think. Hate evil, love good, and establish justice in the gate. Perhaps the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. That's Amos chapter 5, verses 12 through 15. Thus said my Lord God concerning Edom, Christianity. I will make you least among the nations. You shall be most despised. Your arrogant heart has seduced you, you who dwell in cliffs of the rock, in your lofty abode. You think in your heart, who can pull me down to earth? Should you nest as high as the eagle? Should your eye be lodged among the stars? Even from there, I will pull you down, declares the Lord. Obadiah, chapter 1, verse 1. And I will bring distress upon them, that they shall walk like blind men, because they have sinned against the Lord. And their blood shall be poured out as dust, and their flesh as the dung. Zephaniah, Zephaniah, I'm not sure how to say it. Zephaniah, thank you. Chapter 1, verse 14 through 18. As for those peoples that warred against Jerusalem, the Lord will smite them with this plague. Their flesh shall rot away while they stand on their feet. Their eyes shall rot away in their sockets, and their tongues shall rot away in their mouths. Etc. It goes on quite a ways. As Zechariah, chapter 14, verses 12 through 17. Just on a side, just because we were cutting up and being funny, myself in the spirit of the Holy God, who is a person. We couldn't put these videos on if it hadn't been for the coronavirus. It was my stimulus check, the relief check because of the virus and the need for everybody and stimulate the economy. That's how I got this camera and a little light and this big TV behind me. The Spirit asked God. We asked him. I said, you didn't have anything to do with this plague, did you? So that we could get this stuff? He said, of course not. We looked at each other and said, we wouldn't put it past you. Any event, we laughed for an hour over there. Malachi 3 brings a new concept to the day of the Lord. It is God's final word on a day that he is preparing, where a scroll of remembrance will be written at his behest concerning those who revere the Lord and esteem his name. That would include heed the Lord. He does not address the nations, but only Israel and its people. It is written for the return of the Roman dispersion. And why do we say that? It's because of the new covenant. See, a time is coming. That is for the day of the Lord. Because one of the see, a time is coming is Jerusalem's rebuilt, and then it ends with, and you shall never be defeated and overthrown again. Yet Malachi 3, where God makes his declaration of the day of the Lord, when he returns with his messenger who clears the way for him, and the new covenant arrives with the angel of his presence. There's no other way to comment on that. That's who the angel of the covenant that you desire is. It's not the friendship covenant, it's the only other covenant out there. And I will bring distress upon them, that they shall walk like blind men, because they have sinned against the Lord, and their blood shall be poured out as dust, and their flesh as the dung, as I just read from Zephaniah. Okay, this is destroying sinners in the day of the Lord. And then this, yet even now, says the Lord, turn back to me with all your hearts, and with fasting, weeping, and lamenting. Rend your hearts rather than your garments. And turn back to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in kindness, and renouncing punishment. That's from Joel chapter 2. Now, these are examples of writing for the people of antiquity. In the dark ages, that is prophecy, but has nothing to do with the day of the Lord and God's final words on the subject for a time to come, as announced in Jeremiah 31 of the New Covenant. In the day of the Lord, he comes with his messenger and the angel of the new covenant of sin forgiveness, not to destroy sinners or require their repentance, which I hear all the time. He'll come when we get all the Jews to stop sinning and to be observant to the degree that we as human beings are capable. That would be from Jews for Judaism. And see, they rely, their interpretation of Isaiah 53 is the people Israel, the Jewish people as Israel, is based on the Messianic era occurring. You throw that out, and he's got nothing to back up that Israel fits all 12 verses. It's all based on that. It's all based on the nations and their leaders, the kings, saying, oh, we've been wrong about the Jew all the time, exalting them, holding them up high. Okay. Not to destroy sinners will require their repentance, but to forgive them and give them another chance. He also amends the first covenant to be mindful of the teaching of my servant Moses, whom I charged at Horeb with laws and rules for all of Israel, rather than strict compliance. And this is how Malachi starts again. Behold, I'm sending my messenger to clear the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek shall come to his temple suddenly. As for the angel of the covenant that you desire, he is already coming. Malachi chapter 3, verse 1. And keep that in mind, because Jesus Christ uses that verse that I just read, Malachi 3 and 1, to describe John the Baptist, his cousin, as Elijah. But there's some interesting twists to it. The angel of his presence brings the new covenant of Jeremiah 31. God knew in modern times, the secularism and reliance on science, medicine, technology, that his righteous servant might not be recognized, believed, or heeded. The utter destruction of, I think it's verse 24, I think, maybe 23 and 24, is simply on its way of chapter 3, Malachi. Just like it was with the Assyrians, Babylonians, and Romans long ago. Today that would be Islam. God is his creation. And he's not going to personally come down and destroy it as he did Sodom and Gomorrah. It's just another way of saying I'm going to raise up armies. You know, that were already there. The Jewish people didn't heed his prophets and they were destroyed. Taking all these verses of Malachi 3 together, including God returning to his temple, which must be rebuilt, with his messenger clearing the way before him, a new covenant where God forgives the iniquities of the Jewish people and remembers their sins no more, which I have said is just an amendment of the first covenant, the preparing of a scroll of remembrance for those that revere and esteem his name and heed him and enter into heaven, and being mindful of his teachings and laws as observant Jews rather than strict compliance. The concept of the day of the Lord by all previous prophets is changed. The utter destruction prophesied, save for a surviving remnant, is alleviated. There is no mention of the destruction of the nations. It is implied that there will be destruction in the land of Israel, though not necessarily utter destruction. It's the way he phrases it. If you don't do this when I come, it is with utter destruction. Well, does that mean when he comes, there's going to be destruction? But it's only utter if his prophet is not successful? Elijah, in this case, has the same purpose as the righteous servant. To build the third temple, there will be war. in the Middle East causing destruction in Israel and the loss of life among the Jewish people, but it is the building of the third temple that prevents the utter destruction by the nations against Israel. And this goes hand in hand with when you rebuild Jerusalem, see the time is coming, I'm coming back. I have the covenant of friendship with Mashiach, my servant David the shepherd. I'm going to place my sanctuary amongst you, and you shall never be defeated and dispersed again. He has to come back. I mean, that, you see, when you get Jerusalem rebuilt, I'll come back. Clearly he realizes the temple's not here today, and he knew it in the times of Jeremiah. He knows it has to be rebuilt, and he knows he's going to have to be part of that. And to do that, he has to have a Moses, of somebody who can say, this is what we do next. And he's got to have generals listening to that. And he's got to have the Knesset listen to him. And I'll probably, in my opinion, he won't tell me again. He doesn't tell me anything of the future. I have to figure it out for myself. Things that are natural to ascertain, we'll talk about. But I think it would be something like the Six-Day War. I don't think Israel will initiate taking that mount under almost any circumstances, short of a plot by Islam, including the Palestinians, to bring in a nuclear suitcase or two. Something like that may spark things without being attacked by Egypt and Jordan and Lebanon and everybody all at the same time, Iran and their backed Hezbollah. Defeating the enemies of the nations that come against Israel and the sanctification of the land and the people blessed by God with his presence in his sanctuary is how utter destruction is avoided in the awesome, fearful day of the Lord. A day that is not one day, but will begin when he comes to prepare his righteous servant, who is to be his virtual representation and spokesperson until at least his return to his temple. A day that establishes and makes certain that the Jewish people will never be defeated and uprooted again. The Lord's way is clear that only if his righteous servant, who is Elijah, the shepherd David, the prophet like Moses, and of course the righteous servant. One description, four men. He can handle it all. But the way's not going to be cleared if the verses are being shunned, despised, thought to be afflicted by God, by the Jewish people, we're not going to get there. But I believe that changes based on the later verses. Observant and secular alike, accepted as the shepherd David, a leader to tend the flock and be a ruler among them, not as a king with a kingdom, the day of the Lord is the last prophecy of God. In that day, all remaining prophecy of God in the Hebrew Bible is fulfilled. The sending of the prophet like Moses, the descendant of King David and Elijah, with the delivery of the new covenant and the covenant of friendship, all fulfilled in one man. Through one man. The man God calls my righteous servant. One God of Israel. One angel of his presence, and one man, his righteous servant, a man in divine beings, a host of the Lord's hosts, who is God's virtual representation, his spokesperson, and a man he has absolute and total control of, from his mind, emotions, and body, to his every act and his every word. And I am that man. I It's not something you say lightly, I can promise you. If you're listening to a man in divine beings, that they are here right now, speaking to me as I read these things, having me skip when they want me to skip through mine. I said, you got to give me some notes. Come on. He said, we'll give you some notes. I see him change words that I'm saying. Back to this Malachi 3:1 and John the Baptist as Elijah. First and foremost, historically, it cannot be him. Because when he comes, that would be when Jerusalem's rebuilt, because he's in Malachi 3. And that